Hachette Audio presents Disgraceland. Musicians getting away with murder and behaving very badly. Written and read by Jake Brennan. For Johnny Angel, peace. I hope you found it, brother. Author's note. Rock stars aren't like you and me. They act insane and have insane things happen to them. They're more like feral, narcissistic animals than functioning members of society, and this is in part what makes them so damn entertaining. Journalists have dug deep into their past, their personal lives, and into the details surrounding not only their music, but also their insane behavior, including the various crimes they've committed. Friends, lovers, and enemies have sold inside stories to the highest bidders, and some musicians have even penned their own autobiographies in order to ensure the telling of their own history. The stories told in this book rely on all these types of different accounts to piece together a read that is hopefully as wild as the musicians covered within. This book is a stylized interpretation of these stories, melding true crime and transgressive fiction and aligning the musicians, the music they made, and the crimes they committed with the mythology that surrounds them. I am indebted to the journalists, authors, and filmmakers who captured these stories first and got them down onto the record. I am also indebted to a small cast of co-conspirators who were more than generous with their time and offered me firsthand insight into some of the subjects covered herein. And I am indebted to the musicians who lived larger than life, proving themselves to be endlessly entertaining, both on and off record. To all of these folks, I say thank you. Finally, a note about the victims. Each chapter of this book explores real people, not just human collateral damage strewn to the pay no mind list of history, products of the wild living done by the musicians. In this audiobook are dead spouses, relatives, bandmates, friends, and others who bear scars the likes of which we'll hopefully never have to carry. It would be irresponsible if I did not acknowledge them and include a legitimate note of sympathy for both the victims and for those who survived them. It is impossible to research these stories without feeling, at times, intense dread and astonishment at what the worst among us are capable of. I can only imagine that this darkness is but a small portion of the real-life pain felt by those affected by the rock and roll animalism described herein. The beast in me is caged by frail and fragile bars, restless by day, and by night rants and rages at the stars. God help the beast in me. Nick Lowe by way of Johnny Cash. Chapter 1. Fat Elvis. Elvis couldn't get the bullets into the chamber. His fingers, swollen along with the rest of his body from a steady diet of greasy, fried southern food and shaking from his daily narcotics cocktail of antidepressants and pain relievers, morphine, codeine, diazepam, and several other barbiturates, made it near impossible to concentrate, never mind possess the physical dexterity required to properly thread the barrel of his small, snub-nosed revolver with the tiny .38 special bullets. Elvis could feel his temperature rising. He needed to get the gun loaded and get the shot off quick. Who knew how long it would be before the TV gods would deliver that handsome prick's two-faced mug to his television screen again? The sweat on his forehead puddled above his brow and dripped down the side of his bloated face. The volume wasn't working and he needed another kind of release. He'd be up for hours unless he blew off some steam. Blasting Robert Goulet's shit-eating grin off his face with his .38 caliber Smith & Wesson, the one with the TCB logo and lightning bolt on the pistol grip, was likely the only chance left to lower his blood pressure tonight. Goulet. Elvis hated him. Ever since Elvis shipped off to Germany, and Goulet back home moved in on his girl. The bullet slid into the chamber just in time. There! Elvis's heart practically burst through his sternum at the sight of Goulet on screen, appearing in an oft-run commercial for the 1977 television show Police Story. Elvis took aim. He held his fire as the commercial moved through B-plot characters before returning to Goulet. Elvis didn't want to blow it. The shot had to be perfect. He needed to blast Goulet's face the very instant it filled the screen, otherwise his anxiety would remain pitched until morning. Sleep would never come, and he needed to double down on amphetamines the next day to keep going. And besides, at this range, seated 6 feet away from the big RCA, there should only be one result: the kill shot. There! Just then, Robert Goulet's impossibly tan skin and sapphire eyes covered the 25-inch screen. Elvis squeezed his fat sausage fingers against the trigger. Boom! The sound of the 38's blast within the confines of Elvis's Graceland den was deafening, but definitely worth it. Smoke rose out of the hole in his television where the smug face of Robert Goulet had been just 1 second earlier. Elvis sunk into himself with satisfaction. The feeling was almost postcoital, but despite the gratification, Elvis Presley, arguably the most popular entertainer in the world, had never felt more alone. And alone, Elvis kept the wolves at bay, beasts that roamed freely throughout his drug-addled psyche. But one beast raged loudest: the thought of his twin brother, Jesse Garon Presley, dead at birth. And Elvis's survivor's guilt was strong, as was his grief. The twin emotions gnawed away, creating a hole in him that no amount of drugs, women, food, money, fame, or Robert Goulet kill shots would fill. Jesse Garon Presley, the brother, was dead. God save Elvis Aaron Presley, the king. But if someone was going to save Elvis Presley, they'd better do it fast. It was August 1977, and the king of rock and roll was king in name only. He'd been dethroned long ago by the Beatles, who descended like their cousins, the locusts, laying waste to everything before them. Then by sympathetic Satanists posing as harmless Rolling Stones, but who tumbled him like dice off the charts. And most recently by lean anarchists armed with only three chords and the truth. Gone were the heady and innocent days of newfound chart-topping success. His early triumph had been fueled by the accidental creation of a new type of earth-shattering music: rock and roll. Back then, Elvis's grip on the nation was firm. The world had never seen the likes of him before. He was the vessel for a new sound. He naturally infused white southern country music into gut bucket black blues, and in doing so gave rock and roll a level of relatability and crossover commercial appeal that was undeniable. The world shook, parents rattled, and Elvis rolled. Rolled over the naysayers who miscast rock and roll as a fad, rolled over the competition who misjudged him as a one-hit wonder, and rolled over Beethoven, Tchaikovsky, and any and all traditional forms of music that got in his way. His first singles lit up the request lines of radio stations throughout the South, and Elvis quickly outgrew his little hometown record label. It was clear, almost from the jump, that Elvis Presley wasn't just a recording artist. He was a culture-shaping phenom on the make. Back then, in 1955, Elvis was lean himself. To most of America, with his long jet black hair, acne-scarred cheeks, and slithering hips, he was just as alien-looking as the punk rockers who now reviled him were in 1977. In the here and now, holed up in his Graceland mansion den, aka the jungle room, Elvis Presley's kitschy, ostentatious, interior-designed man cave with its animal prints, shag rug, and faux wood, he felt a million miles away from his humble beginnings, despite the fact that he was only a 15-minute drive from 706 Union Avenue, the Memphis address of Sun Studio, where he'd gotten his start a couple decades earlier. Elvis, bored, hit the intercom on the wall and called for Diamond Joe Esposito, an original member of the Memphis Mafia, his entourage who, among other things, kept him entertained when the need for distraction took hold. "Joe, come on down to the den. I want to shake it up tonight." Within minutes, Joe appeared. "Joe, let's party, man. I'm bored. You see those girls outside the gates? Go bring them in the house." "Elvis, there's about 300 people outside the gates right now." "I'm not talking about all those people, just the girls, the older girls. We don't need none of that Jerry Lee nonsense. And tell the boys to get the bar stocked. I want some Italian food. Call up Coletta's and get a bunch of them BBQ pizzas. Let's party, Joe." Within no time, there were roughly 150 women filling the walls of Graceland to accompany Elvis and the 10 members of his Memphis Mafia entourage, shooting fish in a barrel. But Elvis wasn't interested in shooting fish. He sat in his chair and fingered his pistol. It gave Elvis a sense of security in these uncertain times. His career was at an all-time low. He wasn't yet broke, but his massive overhead was threatening to bust his bank. He hadn't had a top 10 hit since Burning Love 5 years earlier, and hadn't had real critical acclaim since Suspicious Minds shot up the charts in 1969. But even then, nearly a decade before, he was still seen as past his prime. They wouldn't have referred to his 1968 NBC special as the comeback special if he'd been reliably ruling his kingdom the whole time. And now, he was a lifetime away from the supernova star status of his early number one hits, Heartbreak Hotel and Don't Be Cruel. Truth be told, Elvis had been creatively spent for the better part of a decade, and physically, he was in the worst shape of his life. To make matters worse, Elvis's manager had him teed up to embark on a rigorous tour. It was a tour that he dreaded and was in no shape to do, physically or mentally. Elvis couldn't help but wonder why he was in this mess. How did it get to this point? Lonely, running out of bread and out of shape. He was only 42 years old, and only a couple decades removed from being the undisputed king of rock and roll. The more he thought about it, the more he came back to blaming the one person he could never confront head on. His manager, the Colonel, Colonel Tom Parker. Colonel Tom Parker had been an outsized figure in Elvis Presley's life ever since 1955. Just as Elvis's first single started to crack the charts. The Colonel was a talent manager, and not actually a colonel. He was born Andreas Cornelius van Kack, was from Breda, Holland, and was in reality an illegal immigrant who'd hoodwinked Jimmy Davis, the Louisiana governor and a one-time country star himself, to bestow upon him the honorary title of Colonel because he thought it made him seem more American. A new identity was a necessity for the Colonel. His days in Holland have been shaded by time, but one theory goes that young Andreas Cornelius van Kack left Holland for the United States to escape a murder rap. Once in the States, he'd grifted his way through the Depression, making ends meet through a series of short cons until eventually finding work on the carnival circuit as a carny barker. It was there, in the carnival, where the wannabe colonel would form his business philosophy. Entertainers, be it an elephant in a ring, a monkey in a cage, a lady with a beard, or a singer with a song, they were all the same. They weren't artists. They were attractions. Once the United States got off the skids and Americans started spending money on entertainment again, Andreas, in the spirit of most hardworking immigrants before him, assimilated and began climbing the social ladder through hard work. The carnival was out. There was money to be made in the devil's workshop, aka the music industry. So he began hustling tickets and dates for country music singers Minnie Pearl and Eddie Arnold, and he eventually built up enough clout to con Governor Davis into giving him that new handle. Now that he was officially the Colonel, he could fully become the prototype of the big barrel-bellied, cigar-chomping American music businessman. Colonel Tom Parker was poised.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.